You're listening to The Mother Love Show, only on LA Talk Radio.
I have in studio an amazing actress, writer, producer. Her career is very diverse. She was born in Boston, Massachusetts, and at the age of 8, she was chosen to be one of the infamous children on Art Link Letters. Children say the kids say the darndest things. She is a first-time author. She's written a wonderful book inspired by a true story called The Whip. Thank you for joining me in studio, ladies and gentlemen. Karen Kardashian. Did I pronounce it right?
You did.
Thank you so much for joining us. Welcome to the program.
Thank you, Mother Love.
So tell me about Miss Karen Kardashian, your life growing up in Boston, working with Art Linkletter, who we love that show. I'm dating myself. You were on Kids Say the Darndest Things. I remember the Art Linkletter show when it was on.
Yes, I was one of those obnoxious children.
He didn't have obnoxious kids. They were cute and adorable with no filter.
That's it. Exactly.
They were not obnoxious. Kids back then weren't obnoxious.
No.
Kids had no filter.
Yeah.
Now they're obnoxious.
No. You know what it was is that we said anything and everything, and those were the times when things were secret in the household.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was a while back when it wasn't yet the hippie, sex, drugs, and rock and roll time, you know?
And the Twitter stage of telling all your personal business every 15 seconds.
Yeah, no, and I remember that he gave us lunch,
mm-hmm.
and he was really nice to us,
mm-hmm.
and I said to him on the air, I said, you know, I want to be, he asked me what I wanted to be, and I said, I want to be a CIA agent. My mother had taken me too many spy movies, I think. Anyway, so
you're the first person I've ever had on the show that wanted to be a CIA agent.
Yes, I did at 8. And so all of a sudden I said, you know what, Mr. Linkletter, I don't want to be a CIA agent anymore. I want to be an actress. And he said, why? And I said, because I get to miss school. And I get all the free grilled cheese sandwiches and orange sherbet I want. You know, they fed me. They fed us a lot, whatever we wanted. And so then it's very strange. At the age of 8, I made my decision, and I never wavered. And it was all because of grilled cheese sandwiches and orange sherbet and missing school.
We work for food. People got to understand. Those of us in show business, we work for food. I work for soap, deodorant, toilet paper, and toothpaste. I work for the basics, you know, and food. You know, when I see the homeless people out there say, I will work for food, I want to hold a sign up and go, me too. I will do the very same thing. And you knew this at 8.
I did.
Now, do you remember one of the darndest, that was your darndest thing that you said to him? I don't want to be a CIA agent. I want to be an actor.
Yes, that's right. And so, you know, I was very fortunate. I got to study in London.
Mm-hmm.
I went to the London Academy of Music and Dramatic Arts, and I became a member of the Actors Studio. And, you know.
And you're still a member of the Actors Studio.
Still.
So now, when you decided at 8 years old, which is very, very young, especially, you know, back in the day when we were making these big declarations, but when you know that you know that you know, and it's, you know, it's time to talk to the adults because they've got to, you know, they've got to buy into your vision and your dream.
Yes.
They've got to take you places. What was your conversation at 8 to your folks about the fact that you knew that this is what you wanted to do? You wanted to be an actor.
Oh, they just thought it was a stage. You know, and then at about 15, my stepfather said, it's a stage, don't worry. And then it just kept going on and on until suddenly, you know, I was in my 20s, and I was now in New York doing theater,
mm-hmm.
and they realized it wasn't a stage anymore.
Yeah, this is not
No.
I don't think this is a phase that Karen's going through. I think we better back her up with this.
That's right.
Now, from the time you were 8 until you were in your 20s, did you start doing stage work?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I was very fortunate. My mama remarried, he married my stepfather.
Mm-hmm.
We went to San Francisco,
mm-hmm.
and there was a famous place called the Actors Workshop, which started kind of the repertory theater in America.
Mm-hmm.
A man named Jules Irving, great, mm-hmm. great man. And I was one of the little children, 12, 13 years old, in their plays.
Mm-hmm.
So there I was. I was very shy. I got very shy all of a sudden after Art Linkletter. And so the
this
theater,
is the little girl who made the big declaration.
Yes.
I'm not going to be a spy. I'm going to be an actor.
That's right. And I still am shy, except, you know, we learn to cover it.
Mm-hmm. You're an actress. This is what you do. You pretend to be somebody you're not.
Well, actually, you know what I found out about acting? The acting is really giving yourself permission to be who you really are. and nobody knows that. Parts of yourself.
Oh, I love that, Karen.
You know, we are, if you delve way down deep, all of us have every kind of potential of anger, rage, love, you know, from the top to the bottom, from being an angel to a devil. We have that. And so actors are athletes of their emotion, and they're able to access, unlike other people who kind of hide it down, we access all those places and those people
that are inside of you.
Inside of us.
Even the people that have done terrible things
Monsters.
To you. And you see, I always thought that, I believe that great actors and actresses come from great pain. Because when they can reach down deep into the and move those layers out of the way to get to that raw emotion, to be and especially stage performers, to be able to do that night in and night out and find those raw emotions, especially when it's like a really, really riveting emotional piece.
Yes.
You know, that's not something that you can just like run up on the stage like a lot of these young people now think I can just go up there and do that. No, you have to understand who you are to be able to play those many people and bring those people out.
I want to tell you something.
Okay.
One of the things that has helped me so much in my life to handle the difficult challenges that we all have, some really bad and some, you know, is that I've learned that all of these things are oil colors that I will paint with in my work. I paint with them these emotions, these feelings, these bad things, these good things. I use them as a result in my acting and in my writing. And so as a result, all the negative things are gifts.
Is it... That when you're doing the pieces, when you're writing, and we're going to get to the whip and what made you write this particular story, which is very fascinating. And I was just like, oh my God, and this is based on a true story. When you get to that place, do you have to like calm yourself? Do you have to go to a certain place to be able to get to all the deep, dark things that you've gone through and not allow the ugliness of it to overtake you, to be able to do the work on stage, to be able to put it down on paper, to be able to produce it in a piece?
Yes. You know, Lee Strasberg was my teacher. He was the one who started the Actor's Studio, or one of the people. And he taught us methods of accessing our feelings. And one of the things that I did as a writer was I used my acting training to write and use some of these techniques. Now, to answer your question about emotions, let's say that I played Maria Callas, the great opera singer, in the master class for about a year here in Los Angeles. It was lovely. And you can
sing too, huh?
Well, actually, the role was when she had lost her voice.
Ah.
So she's teaching at Juilliard these students. Mm-hmm. Okay, now there's a moment in it, a very heavy moment, when she wanted a child more than anything, and Onassis, that Jacqueline Kennedy married,
Aristotle Onassis.
Yes, was her lover. And he said, look, if you have this baby, you're pregnant. If you have this baby, I'm going to leave you. So she wanted this child, but for him, she had an abortion. And he left her anyway. So there's this moment when it's a cry from the deepest part of yourself. And to find that, you know, you have to dig deep. And then you just have to trust and let it out and use it. And that's what I did. I used
So you took your inner pain and pulled it out to play this heavy moment in this piece.
Yes, and some of us, you know, it doesn't necessarily have to be that I had an abortion, but it's the same kind of loss. And so that's what you have to ask.
And you just match up the loss with loss.
That's it.
And loss is loss.
Yes, and you know what you're teaching people as an actor and writer? You're teaching them what it is to be a human being.
And to not, whether you're, that it's all right to be a flawed human being. Because we always think, you know, don't let anybody see a chink in my armor. No. Don't let them know that I'm not infallible. Wait a minute, I'm Superwoman. I have an S on my chest. I'm Superman. No, and then when you can, and that's what I love and appreciate about actors, and especially the good ones who are not afraid, who trust their instinct, who trust their emotions enough to let it out. How do you, when you let out a heavy moment like that, how do you, and can you bring it back in quickly?
That's part of your training. Mm-hmm. Of course, as a human being, I mean, if you were letting it out, you can't let, you have to, you know, express it totally. Mm-hmm. But the actor has to be able to use it and then, of course, be able to speak after that and continue.
Right.
And so that's where your training comes in, and that's where the great method, that Lee Strasberg and the Actor Studio teaches how you do that.
And train your body to because when you're doing like a really heavy scene and you're putting everything into it, and then you got to start talking, you know, well, then you got to like, okay, I got to calm down. Okay, let me get back into the scene.
Well, that's why actors, Lee Strasberg used to say, we're athletes of the emotions.
I love that. We're athletes of the emotions.
Yes, which means, of course, that, you know, you are an athlete, you know, mm-hmm. can run, 3 miles or whatever he runs, and he doesn't collapse. Yes, he's exhausted, but he's trained himself.
Mm. Right.
So it's the same thing with the
actors. Same things with the actors. And I'm just so pleased to know that you still have such a passion for it. And so what made you want to write this story, The Whip, about Charlie Parkhurst?
Well, years ago, when I was in my 20s, I read an article in Cosmopolitan magazine about wild women of the West. Mm-hmm. And there was an article about her. And I thought, wow, look at her. How did she manage to pass mm-hmm. with all these macho guys that she was with? How did she, I mean, it's a woman. Oh, she doesn't have facial hair. Mm-hmm. She, you know, how did she, like...
go to the bathroom? How was she peeing?
That's right.
And what happened when she was having her menses? How did
that's
she...
exactly you know? Right.
Like, what?
All these things that a woman goes through. Mm-hmm. And she was with all these macho guys all the time, 24, almost 24 a day. Mm-hmm. You know, and so the years went by, and I decided I would write a screenplay. So I did in my 40s, and it was okay, not a great screenplay.
About the whip.
Mm-hmm. But what happened was, a friend of mine was at William Morris, an agent, and she took it on, and William Morris took it, and they actually sold it to mm-hmm. someone. This is now before cable.
Okay.
So here's this guy, and he's trying to sell on CBS cross-dressing.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
that was not going.
That was not happening.
They were like, "Where did she come from?"
Yeah. So the script came back to me. Years later, my mommy passed away, and I.
God rest her soul.
Yeah.
We belong to the Dead Mamas Club.
That's right, my dear mama. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, you know, I want to dedicate something to her. Mm-hmm. And I've always wanted to write this story. It's haunted me a bit. Mm-hmm. It's almost like she haunted me to write it. You know, do it, mm-hmm. do it. And I'm going to write a novel.
Like your mother haunted you or Charlie was haunting you?
I think Charlie.
Okay.
Charlie. And so I thought, I don't know if I can do this. Now, I was a journalist a bit, mm-hmm. so I had written. Mm-hmm. But that's not writing a novel. That's a whole other thing. So I sat down, and I took a lot of classes. I did a lot of reading. And, you know, and 6 years and 27 drafts later, you get the whip. It took 6 years. Because there was a lot of research in it too, and you know
I'm amazed at how much information you got when there were very few records about
That's right.
And you know there were pretty much like legendary stories about her. You know, this is a white woman
in the
West coming out here to San Francisco riding a stagecoach. They did not have women. Women were delicate. You put them on a pedestal.
That's right.
You keep them at home. You put them in pretty dresses. You don't get and you don't dress like a man and live like a man and do a man's job. And wait a minute, not just stagecoach, and the chick was a lumberjack.
Yeah, that's right. Look at you. You've done a lot of
research. The chick was a lumberjack.
Too.
Wait a minute. The horse kicked her in the head, and you know, most, oh, my face rejected. Oh, no, I can't do it. I'm melting. I'm melting. She put a patch on her eye and said, you know, let's roll with the flavor,
that's
baby. Let's roll with
right.
the flavor. What you want?
She was blind in one
she
eye.
She was blind in one eye, and was still riding with
that's
four
right.
and six horses. Men were impressed with her skills.
That's right. She lived 30 years.
30 years as
and
a man.
And when they got her ready for her funeral,
everybody was freaked out.
They couldn't believe she was a woman.
I thought he was going to have a heart attack right there. I thought he was going to have a heart attack. I said, the man is going to, she done killed the man off, and I done got through the whole story with him.
Yes.
She done killed the man off. Because, you know, and I want to know, why did you break it down into book one and book two? Because,
well,
you know, book one, you know, got you all, you know, caught up, and, you know, it tells such a riveting story.
It's her background.
Yeah.
It's the reason that she put on the men's clothes.
Mm-hmm.
And the second, book two, is, so the first one is Charlotte
mm-hmm.
Parkhurst, and the second one is
Charlie
Parkhurst. And, you know, the thing that I did was I went, yes, I did the research,
mm-hmm.
and in fact, in the back of the book, as you noticed,
mm-hmm.
there's the New York Times obituary.
Yes.
And by the way, when they wrote about her at the end after she died, they asked for relatives to come and claim
nobody
her.
Nobody came.
Nobody came. Because she lived in an orphanage. She was raised in an orphanage. She didn't know her mom and dad. So nobody came. But anyway, back to we were talking
did
about.
Did you take creative license in giving her a background, because there was not a lot of documentation
okay,
about her?
There were, you know, the things that were true about her is she was the first woman to vote in America as a man. No.
So she was the
no,
first woman to vote, even though she said
yes.
the suffragettes
yeah,
was like raising
right.
all kind of
that's
sand
it.
When she got there.
That's
she
it.
Went in. She went in and voted as a man.
For General Grant.
Right, for General Grant.
Yes.
She goes in and votes. She knows she's a woman. Everybody else is believing she's a man. She's the first woman to vote in America.
Yes.
We are not taking that away from her.
No.
And this is back in the 1860s, people.
That's
this
fine.
Is way back in, talk about way back in the day. This is way back in the day. And she was so convincing as a man.
Yeah.
See, that's the part that freaked me out, because, you know, she wasn't a big person.
No.
You know, she had a small demeanor.
Yes.
Never grew facial hair. How you peeing in the woods? Nobody ever. You never. I mean, men pee in groups. You
yes,
know,
they do.
Pee in the snow and they write their names and they do weird things like that. You know, and she was not. She was a young woman. She could. Yeah. She was still going through her menses.
Yes.
They said that she was a mother. Did you ever find any proof that she had ran away with a slave and had a baby?
Okay,
with
her middle name was Darkie.
Yeah, I saw that. That's what I was like, okay, come on.
Okay, now listen, we don't know what her, she probably made up her names because, you know, she didn't want anyone to, she didn't want to carry her identity from the East Coast when she came to the West Coast.
Right.
Okay, because now she was a man.
Right, now she's Charlie.
So I'm positive she changed her name. Darkie in the 1800s, obviously meant African American.
Right.
Okay. So when I went to Watsonville, which is where she is buried, in the Odd Fellows Cemetery.
The Odd Fellows?
She was an odd fellow.
Say the least, an
yes,
odd fellow.
But that was a charity group, you know, of men.
Right.
Anyway, so I went and spoke with a lot of, not three people, who whose great great grandparents knew her. And now these are rumors. I can't make these as facts. But they were saying that the rumor was that she had been with a runaway slave, and that something had happened to her and her child. And that's why she came to California to get away from whatever or to come to. Now, I felt, you know, listen. Yes, he was a free man, the slave.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I decided I was going to novelize the rumors.
Mm-hmm.
So I took all the rumors that these people gave me, and I novelized them, along with the facts.
Mm-hmm.
The facts being, of course, that she was a famous Wells Fargo stagecoach
Wells Fargo. Wells Fargo is still going, one of my banks, thank you. Tell people, first of all, what a whip is.
a whip is a stagecoach driver. Because they had these 20-foot snakeskin whips. And, you know, by the way, a stagecoach driver was like the rock star of his
time. Of the West, yes.
You know, I mean, people...
They're like the Pony Express people.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, all the girls were in love with them. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't matter if they were 80 years old. And so, you know, she really got the top plum position.
You know, and there's something else in the book. I don't want to give everything away because we want people to get the book and get the real meat of it. But when she was being Charlie, being the guy, and the lady liked her because she thought she was a man.
Yeah.
You know.
In love with her.
Matter of fact, I wasn't going that far. I was just going to let him, I was just giving him a little piece, just a little something, just a little piece.
Well, the thing about her that's interesting is that she really did kill the famous outlaw Sugarfoot.
Yeah, she killed.
Robbed your stagecoach many times.
And that was one of the drawbacks of being a whip is because you got these highwaymen that are looking for your stagecoach and telling you drop the box, just put the box down, robbing the stagecoach, and she just I'm about sick of you.
Yeah.
You know, but got on my last working nerve. Now, you done robbed me one too many times. I'm going to pop a cap in your behind. Leave your nail behind out here on the road because you done got on my nerve. See, that's what you do. You don't piss the women off like that. Should have been a dead giveaway right there. You know.
Oh, my God, you're funny.
And nobody knew until she died. And, you know.
No, they didn't. And when they got her ready for the funeral, the doctors were coming from San Francisco all over to check out her body.
Right.
Because she was so famous. Mm-hmm. You know, if you go to the Wells Fargo Museum in San Francisco, there's a little corner about her. They have a whole little, that's where I got some of my research material.
Oh, I wonder why they only have a little corner. Maybe because they couldn't believe that some little tiny woman had outsmarted them enough, but she made such an impact that we got to tell the story.
That's right.
Somebody's got to know
this.
You
know what? I want to tell you something. You know, I don't want to get into politics here, but...
Oh, we can get into politics, honey. This is our show.
Listen,
Karen, this is the mother-loving Karen show.
I want Hillary Clinton to become president in
2016.
Yes. And you know what? Why I bring that up is because, you know, this book is about a powerful woman.
Mm-hmm.
And
first of all.
Yeah. And, you know, it's going to become the time, I think, of the powerful woman. I think if Hillary Clinton gets into office... You know?
How about if we just go when she gets into office?
How about that?
How about when?
Okay, when Hillary Clinton gets into office, it's coming towards that time. You know, I'm going to tell you something. In those days, in the 1800s, women couldn't have dreams. You couldn't have one single dream except
having... You couldn't
even
speak up.
No, that's right. It was, you know, shut your mouth. And, in fact, some of the women called their husbands Mr. They did.
Yeah.
And, you know, but you...
Sir.
Sir.
I'm like, look, I'm sleeping with you. I got you, sir, all right. See, that I would not have lasted one day.
We would not have lasted.
We
were free spirits.
Yes.
We would have both been on a stagecoach. Mm-hmm. I'm sure. Do you know that there was the only other female who was on a stagecoach as a whip, as a woman? Was an African-American woman.
I totally believe that.
Yeah, but she was, everyone knew she was a woman.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she drove as a woman. But this was not in California. This was out, I think, in the Midwest somewhere. Mm-hmm. But I'm just saying, look at us.
And look at how far we've come. And look at how far. And I believe that we as women are going to be the driving force to change the course of history. Men have been doing this for 400 and something years. You guys have jacked it up. You guys have jacked it up. We let you do what you thought that you can do. But listen, you guys have lucky socks. We don't have lucky underwear. We put on our big girl panties and we go out and we do the doggone thing. You know, men are the worst patients. Doctors are even worse. They're just a bunch of babies. You know, I couldn't hang now. I got a car. Shut up. We'd be bleeding like a stuck pig once a month. Got a baby on our hip, another one in our belly, and we cooking and whipping up everything, and you coming here talking about, I'm bringing my boss home, and I thought you should, if you don't get out of my face, I'll cut your neck off your head. And then you got to look pretty.
Oh, my God, you're funny.
But you got to be pretty. And we all, when you stop and think about it, even throughout the course of history, Karen, women have, they always have said, behind a great and powerful, successful man, there's a powerful, successful woman driving him and pushing him and letting him know that he can do these great things.
That's
because men need to be nurtured.
That's That's right. And they need to be inspired.
They have to be. Look, when God made man, he was like, oh, you're going to need some help. Let me, we didn't get to help me. We got kids.
I know.
We got periods. We got menstrual cycles. We got mental illness. How come all our problems start with men? Menopause, menstruation, mental illness, and menopause.
Oh, that's funny. I never thought of that.
That's why I'm here. And I know why they, call it menopause. Pause it over there. After a while, you just want to move it over there, honey. Move it over there. Oh, and that's probably, how Charlie was feeling. I'm a woman, but I'm a strong woman, and I can stand up here shoulder to shoulder with you, toe to toe if I have to, and I can do this
that's
job.
Right. And she did.
And was good at it.
And, one of the things I did was the book is about forgiveness. That's the river that runs through the book is someone I don't want to spoil it for you readers out there, but someone she loves very much is horribly murdered.
Mm-hmm.
So she puts on men's clothes and goes out to California to find the killer.
That's where her quest started.
Yes. And, it's like the book is her trying to revenge herself, yes, but also to let go.
She is.
And finally she finds out that in every problem there is a gift in its hand, and we create the problem because we need the gift.
Mm-hmm. That is so profound. And so many people, they lose that part in transition, even when it's something negative that they can't. I always think when bad things happen to you, it's not the bad things that are happening to you. It's how you deal with the bad
things that happen
to you. So we can make a choice. We can make a choice to be a victim and wallow in it. Or we can make a choice and say, this has happened to me. I did not bring this upon myself. And I'm going to rise above this. This is,
make a gift out of it.
And make a gift out of it, even if, whatever it is. A lot of people, and I've often seen this with women who have been sexually assaulted, women who've been raped, women who've been molested. They hold it in so much, and they just never let it go. And then it's like a pressure cooker when it does explode. All hell could break loose. But you give that person who's done this horrible thing to you, you give them the power.
Yes.
You take the power back and say, you don't get to have no power, plain and simple.
That's right.
And you rise up, and I'm never going to say it's going to be easy, but it can be done. And this is what Charlie did.
Yes, she did. And the other thing is we're talking about people who take a terrible thing and make it into a gift.
Mm-hmm.
I have a friend who was the producer of the audiobook of The Whip, and he got ALS just out of the clear blue sky, just like a month, 2 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
And, you die from that horribly. It's like quicksand.
A slow death.
And what he's doing that's so magnificent is that he is doing videos, a video diary every day for people who have ALS and dreadful diseases to encourage them, to help them, just tell them how he's handling it.
That's
and he's
beautiful.
Trying to help. That's what I mean.
Oh, he's not trying to help. He is helping.
He is helping.
The fact that he is taking this dreaded disease and turning it into a positive to help other people. And not just people with ALS, but people who are dealing with a chronic disease or a devastating disease. And that's what we have to do. That's what we have to do. That's what Charlie did. Charlie lived her life as a compassionate, loving, kind person. Now don't act a fool now.
Yeah.
Don't get crazy, because I will stand up for myself.
That's right.
But she was never like crazy, and she could have just really went off the deep end if she had chose to and hurt a lot more people, but she didn't.
That's right.
She decided. Did you see while you were writing? Did you see any of Karen's characteristics in this character as you were writing her?
Well, as an actor, in every character, including the men, there are my characteristics.
Mm-hmm.
I have a question. Who of all the characters in the book, which one do you feel closest to?
Oh.
Including the men.
Including the men, who did I feel closest to? Well, I loved all of them.
Yeah.
So who did I feel closest to? I felt closest to Charlie.
Charlie, okay.
I felt closest to Charlie when Charlie was, you know, because at first, you know, the first part of the book, she's Charlotte.
Yeah.
You know, and then in the second part of the book, she's like Charlie, you know, and I'm watching this young woman, this young orphan grow up into to this blossoming woman, fall in love, you know, have a baby, and then all hell breaks loose on her, you know, and she's like, you know what? I am not going to be a victim of my circumstance. And she made a conscious choice to come west, dress as a man, live as a man. This wasn't like a fleeting thing. She lived like a man for all of just about all of her adult life.
That's right.
Until the day she died.
That's right.
And she rent her clothes and they were like, what the what?
Nobody knew her secret.
Nobody knew, not the woman, not Monk, not anybody. So talk about a good actress. This chick was a brilliant actress.
I know. I, you know, the other thing I thought about is how would you live your life without being able to share your feelings, your heart? How would you live without, you know, because she has a secret. She can't ever talk about her life or her past.
She could, but she chose not to confide in anybody. So she's got all this angst in her. I think probably a lot of that. And maybe you, this is what I'm thinking, because she had so much in that she was holding in for so long, you know, and she still is a passionate person, that maybe that's why she got so sick.
Yeah, I know. But, you know, part of what she got sick from is she died the same way General Grant did, which was, of course, the man she voted for, which was mouth and tongue cancer. Now, that comes from too many cigars, too much chewing tobacco, and too much liquor.
And she smoked liquor. She smoked liquor and drank tobacco.
Yeah, she was a big, you know, she chewed tobacco and smoked cigars.
Like a man, too.
Like a man. And she loved them.
Because this is what she was doing. As you're writing this, and with your very skilled acting background, what did you discover, or did you discover anything new and fresh about Karen while you're writing this in your acting, about you personally?
Well, I'll tell you one thing is that I didn't think I would have the patience and the stamina and the grit to finish a book, because it requires you to over and over and over. I mean,
and 27 drafts
is a lot.
Look, I've did
and
three.
6 years.
I've did three books.
You did.
I've written three books. I'm working on my fourth book, and I'm like, I know what that process is like. You can pull your hair out to get it right.
Yes, and you have to have some kind of, you know, there has to be a kind of, you have to be possessed almost. You have to be, you know,
step outside of your world and into a completely different world.
Because you isolate yourself when you write. Now, by the way, I would like to share something for all those writers out there. A little trick. You know how everybody wants to write a book? I mean, they have a story in them, because everybody does have a great story, whether it's their family or an idea they have. And that is to sit down with a tape recorder and a friend, put on Dragon software, which translates, or, you know, it takes the words you speak and puts it into words on the page, and then you put it on the computer. There it is, and you've got like 50 pages, and it doesn't have to be from beginning to end. It can be, you can start in the middle, at the end, wherever you want, and now you've got all these pages that, you know, like a little puzzle you put together. It's that first sentence that people can't begin. They go like, it's not right, it looks, sounds terrible, and then they stop.
And it's not a dark and stormy night.
Yeah, that's right, and they, and you know, and Once Upon a Time. And so, you know, if you have a story, sit with a best friend, and just, and have them ask you questions, and you just talk about this idea of yours and get it on paper and begin it. You know, I mean, a lot of people have family history. Imagine what your how grateful your great-great-grandchildren would be to know who you really are.
And so much history, it has been lost because they don't, you know, back in the day, you didn't discuss, you know, your history. You didn't tell them. And I remember as a little girl sitting at my great-grandmother and my grandmother's and my mother and my aunts and my sitting at their feet. And I would sit up under the table and listen to these rich stories about, you know, these that I later found out are really famous people, you know. And I'm sitting up under the table, and they might uncross their leg and they kick the tongue. They were like, baby, get from up under that table. And I remember I must must have been about 11 years old, and they were in like this really heavy conversation about men and relationships. And I was going to be late for school, and it was early in the morning. They were having their morning coffee, and my grandparents had come down and everything, and they're having this whole conversation. And I'm up under the table, and my aunt accidentally kicked me. And my mother said, "Do you want me to get a tape recorder and record the conversation?" I was like, "Could you? Would you please?" And from that point on, I was determined to get me a job to buy my mother a tape recorder. Aww. Because I wanted her to record her life and her history, because we came from a verbal history and we need to share these stories. I mean, just think, if it hadn't been for your tenacity and your wherewithal to say her story needs to be told, we might not never know about this. Yeah. I mean, I never knew that there was I did know that there was a black lady stagecoach driver, but I did know that there was a woman who was a whip who was dressed like a man for 30 years, and they did not find out about her story until she passed away. This is a riveting story, and this is a piece of history. And maybe now, you know, maybe she didn't have any relatives, but she left such a footprint for young women. Yeah, yeah. What footprint did she leave for you?
That anything is possible. That if you have a passion and a dream, particularly, hers was, of course, to revenge in the beginning. But if you, whatever your dream is, you've got to put your arms around life. I mean, you know, I don't know if you caught this, but the book begins, I think it's around the third chapter. She's dying, and she inhales. And the whole book is that one breath until the end of the book where she exhales. I feel like life is one breath, and that we've got to live life. I really wanted people to get that sense that, you know, the whole of her life was a breath.
Mm-hmm.
And yours is too.
And that's what our lives are.
And
when we're born,
we take
a breath going in to fill our lungs, and then the baby starts screaming, and you take a breath going out when you leave the planet.
That's right. And so, you know, in that breath, not only should we have joy and give joy, but we should try to live some of our dreams, whatever they are. And I know people go like, "Oh, maybe I want to, you know, I'd like to be a nurse."
Try it then.
And I'm 50 years old.
Try it.
I want to be a nurse. That's it.
Try it.
Whatever. There's an age is not the limit. We know that. You can be anything you want now. Just go ahead and do it.
What do you think is, in your opinion, because you have lived you continue to live your dream as an actor, as a writer, and I'm sure that you have other dreams on the horizon.
CIA agent? No.
Look, I can't run and jump like that anymore.
No.
I can't run and jump like that. But because we all continue to have dreams, and once you fulfill a dream and you get a vision and you go, "I'm going after this and this is what I'm going to do," wow, I did that. Now what more else can I do? That's what my grandkids say. Aww. Well, we want to do some more else stuff.
Aww.
So let's do some more else stuff. And people oftentimes think, you know, well, this is it, especially as they start getting older. Well, this is it.
Yeah.
I'm done. I did all this, got married, raised my kids. Okay, I'm retired from a job. Could you imagine retiring, Karen?
Never. No, I don't even want to retire when I'm, you know, on the next plane. When I'm gone, I want to still be doing. I'll be one of those angels, you know. You want me to do the work? I'll do it, you know. I'll go down there and help somebody.
What has been the greatest joy for you as we get more seasoned and we realize, look, y'all don't even have to take that crap anymore. What has been one of the most liberating things for you as you've become a more seasoned person, a more seasoned actor?
That I don't censor myself anymore.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, I do believe anything's possible. Mm-hmm. So, you know, lots of things manifest right out of the clear blue sky now because I believe they can happen.
Mm-hmm.
Wild things, which I won't go into, but have. The other thing is, you know, I know this sounds funny, but with all my, I mean, funny in terms of like, it's not about me, it's about others.
Mm-hmm.
One of the biggest pleasures and makes me cry almost is that I didn't realize that out of writing this book, I get letters. I got a letter from a woman from Ohio. She said to me,
"That's my home state."
You're kidding.
I'm a book out for life.
All right. Well, this letter was a lady friend in a small town in Ohio, an email. And she said, "My husband died. My son has tried to commit suicide. Mm-hmm. I have lost the house. I hardly have any insurance. I hang out at the library. I saw your book in the new section of books for the new books. Mm-hmm. I took it. I read it. She said, I have to tell you something. It's given me courage now to survive these things. She said, if Charlie could survive it, I can. Well, it made me cry. It was like, oh my God, that I actually, the book, Charlie, this book actually gave courage to someone.
It gave courage to me.
Oh.
It really did, because I'm thinking, okay, here we are in the 21st century. Life be trying to kick my behind, but it's not going to be an easy win, you know, and I'm a fighter and I'm tenacious and I'm determined. And in reading this, she added to my tenacity and into my determination, because I live like a chick, you know, I'm all girl all the time, and she can do this. And with the limited resources that she had, and I have access to all these resources, there's no reason for me not to continue to succeed and go to a higher level and to bring as many people with me as I possibly can to get to that higher level. And I know that that's what I'm destined for.
And you're doing it, not destined, you're doing it with this extraordinary show.
Oh, why, thank you very much.
Oh, my God, it's true. You inspire me. You've gotten me tears in my eyes a couple of times.
Because we two waterheads. Let's just keep it real. We just two waterheads, because when you have a passion for people, and you can see the love that you have in your eyes, and I can see the light around you, and feel the passion in your heart from your hug. You know, you could tell a lot about a person from their hug.
I know.
And when you can, when the fact that you allow me to be in your space, and I allow you to be in my space, and we can connect as women, as sisters, as professionals, and forget all that old crazy stuff out there, because you know, when we walk out that door, this is a crazy town.
That's right.
This is a crazy town with crazy people, and we fit right in. We fit right in.
We're good actors.
And we're really good at. I tell them all the time, I'm a good actress. I'm a good actress. I act like I like people that I don't like. But now I'm like, I have, you know, it's like being a kid again. You know, once you get a woman of a certain age,
yes, yes.
You know, when you little kids, like when you were on Art Linkletter show,
yes.
Kids say the darndest things. No filter.
No.
So then when you get to be a certain age, no filter.
That's right. And in between, unfortunately.
You got to be filtered through everything.
I was filtering and doing things and saying things and being things that I wasn't authentic at all. And it broke my heart. And I thought, if I don't want to take my last breath. And number one, have lived my life for everybody but me. Two, and to have not told the truth, not be me, who me is, for better or worse.
When did you realize that, okay, this crap is not working for me, this unauthentic Karen is not working, and it's got to go?
When did that happen?
Because sometimes the light goes on,
yeah,
you know, an event happens, you know, something could happen to you, and you just go, this is not going to, this
you
is
know,
not working for me.
When it happened was... when both my parents were gone,
mm-hmm.
Suddenly I don't really have family,
mm-hmm.
And suddenly I realized that I didn't have to please anybody anymore. Because you know how we always want to please our parents. That's the one we don't realize.
Because we're good girls.
And boys too.
And boys too.
Men want to please their moms and dads, whether they admit it or not.
Right.
And so when that happened, now my parents are with me. I take them on trips. I do everything. And I celebrate with them,
mm-hmm.
my life. But, you know, when I was younger, I was, you know, I was afraid of everything that I did and said. I was one of those girls that, what will the neighbors say?
Because your parents had instilled that in you. Karen, you do not go outside of this house and embarrass us.
That's right.
What goes on in the house stays in the house. You don't go out and tell the business. Now, do you have brothers and sisters?
No, I don't.
You're an only child?
I am.
See, there were six of us.
Oh, my God.
So we had to go down the line. You can't tell anybody anything that goes on in this house. That's period. My mother ran it like a totalitarian dictator. And that's what she said. In here, this is a totalitarian dictatorship. We the only kids in the projects that got to go look up get a dictionary and a thesaurus and the Bible and the Quran and the Rosicrucian to figure out what she's saying to us, because she done said some crazy stuff to us. I mean, we would get cussed out and you needed a dictionary to find what's a whirling dervish. We had to go find out what the whirling dervishes is. You got to find out what the clatterbone on a goose's butt is. And it was just, as I got older and I realized my mother was so funny. She was, when I was young, I thought she was crazy. And then one day I woke up and she was like a genius, you know. And I was that daughter that did not want to disappoint my mother.
I know.
But I always disappointed her because my mouth just would not I just couldn't shut up. I just.
And look at the gift now because of that beautiful mouth of yours, and you're giving to everybody.
I work to do that because do you see that? I treat people like I want to be treated, and I might not see you ever again in life. So I want our, this is for all people. I want our time together, however limited, however long, to be fun, to be exciting, you know? So when people come into the, when you go into a place, I know you just light up the whole room, you know? So tell me what you're working on now with promoting the book.
Yes, I am. And you know,
and I tell people how they can get the whip.
I just finished the script of it now. The script of the
You book. Actually
yesterday.
Did
Yeah.
You heard it here on the Mother Love Show. You heard it here on the Mother Love Show. You got the exclusive that the script is coming out. Okay, the screenplay is coming out. So now, is it better this time than it was the first?
Oh my God, yes. I think so. It's really, I'm kind of really proud of it. So we'll see.
Who's going to play Charlie?
Well, we don't know, but I have dreams.
Who's on your dream cast?
A couple. Jennifer Lawrence, Cate Blanchett.
Cate Blanchett, you think
Oh, my. Remember her playing Bob Dylan?
She did
Academy Award.
Awesome.
Nomination.
She got a nomination. She should have got it.
Yeah, but I mean, she can do anything. Mm-hmm. Who do you think? Tell me. You give me some names.
I'm thinking an unknown. I'm thinking out of somebody
with
this.
I'll tell you what. In a way, you're absolutely right. You know why? Because then you're not looking at like, oh, look at Cate Blanchett
playing a
man.
Right.
You know?
I'm seeing an unknown, somebody who can play both of that and maybe not be as soft, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Yeah, and then I totally think, you know, you're really right. It should be an unknown. You know who would be wonderful?
Because this movie will make him a star.
You know who would be wonderful? Hmm. Because she's not a big movie star, is Robin Weigert, she was the one who read the book. She was on Deadwood. She played Calamity Jane on Deadwood.
Okay, I know who you're talking about.
And she read the book. She was the reader, the narrator of my book.
What did she think? I know she loved it.
Oh, my God. She loved it, and she would be brilliant. Mm-hmm. You should hear her read that book. I mean, she plays all of the characters. She's amazing. But I was going to say, and then my dream, of course, is Clint Eastwood.
Who's he going to play? He's directing or is he going to play? He's
going to
direct.
You know, we're talking about dreams here.
Okay.
You know?
Hey, we can dream as big as we want to dream here on the Mother Love Show. So Clint Eastwood is directing because he's an awesome director.
Yes.
I had his daughter on the show not too long
ago. You're kidding.
Mm-hmm. Kimber.
Which one?
Kimber.
Oh, my God. Good for you.
Yep. Oh, we have all kind of fun. Look, I got Karen on the show with me. What are you talking about? I have an award-winning actress. She won the Los Angeles Drama Critics Circle Award for Best Actress in the Rose Tattoo. So back that up. You got a whole bunch of awards and nominations, including an Ovation, a Drama Critics Circle, LA Weekly, and Garland's for Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, which is one of my favorite plays.
That's an amazing
that
play.
That was, oh, my. Do you have a favorite piece that you've done?
Yes.
What's your favorite?
I have two of them.
Okay.
One is Rose Tattoo.
Of course.
And the reason, besides the beautiful play, is that Tennessee Williams came to see it. And he loved it, and so he gave me the rights to all his plays while he was alive. So I
shut the front door.
So then I did Sweet Bird with a young Ed Harris, you know, the actor.
When he had hair?
Yes, that's right. He was hot and sexy.
He's still sexy.
And he is.
I don't care nothing about
that
hair. He's still cute.
Believe me, sexy. And he gave me the West Coast premiere rights to Vous Querez, which is one of his plays. The other play that I love doing is Masterclass, playing Maria Callas. Those are my two favorites. And, you know, I may be doing something, I can't talk about it yet, but, you know, in about a little while, that may be fascinating. And thank God I do some television, you know, still. Play a lot of gypsies and psychics if I see another crystal ball.
You're about ready to look. Okay, come on. Do you feel typecast?
Well, look, you're lucky if you get typecast. That means you get work a lot on television.
Because we're looking for a Karen type.
That's what they do. I mean, you know, actors complain about it, but that's how you work.
When they say get a mother love type, I'm like, don't get a mother love type. Get mother love.
Yeah, that's
right. Get the mother love.
Exactly right.
So you say you got another project that's coming up.
Yeah.
The screenplay for The Whip has been written.
Yes.
So you're ready to start shopping that around?
Yeah, actually, it's, you know,
you're
it's in some hands now.
Oh, so we'll you're working fast,
we'll
girl.
See. Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
Please make sure you invite me to the premiere when the movie's done.
Oh my God, front row center.
I would love to. Tell people how they can get in touch with you and how they can get the whip.
Okay, well, if you want to write to me, you can write to me through my it's condazion.com, and you spell my name KONDAZIAN. .com. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the book is on, you know, for the cheaper versions, you can get it on Amazon and Barnes and Noble. Mm-hmm. That's much cheaper. I think it's like half price.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
A new book?
There's hardbacks that are coming out.
Okay.
There's the audio book that you can get on audible.com that you can put on your iPhone or whatever. And it's on iTunes. So, you know, it's everywhere. It's just like all books now. They're
right.
Everywhere.
They're everywhere. They're so can everywhere. The people still also get your Actors Encyclopedia of Casting Directors?
Yes, they can. And that was a book I did. I was a journalist for Backstage West, mm-hmm. and did these weekly articles on interviewing casting directors, agents, people like that. In fact, I interviewed James Cameron, mm-hmm. just around the Titanic time. Mm-hmm. He gave a great interview about acting, film acting. Mm-hmm. That's in the book. And that's on, you know, so
you can find it anywhere.
Can find it for about 5 cents now on Amazon. I'm not exaggerating.
And in the meantime, The Whip is available. It's based on a true story. It is about the first woman. It's inspired by a true story of a woman, Charlotte Charlie Parkhurst, who lived most of her extraordinary life as a man in the West. Miss Karen, it has been my distinct honor and pleasure to sit and chat with you. Mm. I thank you so much for sharing Charlie's story with us.
I love you, Mother.
And I love you back. May the universe continue to open up and conspire for your great success.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Same to you.
Thank you, Miss Karen Kardashian. And we'll be back after this.